So the talk here today, the topic is that how do we address the data sparsity challenges for pedestrian understanding? So I think that we will hear a lot of great talk. People are talking about the challenges of data sparsity. This is a very common challenge for self-driving. So for example, we can see that we will find a lot of events of interest that is really real to mine. For example, you will see a lot of pedestrians sitting down or crouching in the street. Some of them were jaywalking. Most of them were just confined to traffic rule. So these are very real events. It's really hard to find them in the data. And the second point I want to highlight here is that labeling is also very expensive for many of the pedestrian understanding tasks. For example, if you want to predict the 3D key points of the pedestrians, it could be really, really expensive to label. So in this talk, we try to present a few methods that we explore to tackle the data sparsity issues. We can categorize them into three groups. One is that how do we do data augmentation and also synthetic data generation. Second one is that in addition to generating those data, how can we leverage the existing labels or easy to get labels more efficiently through weak supervision? The third one is that how do we use self-supervision and joint training to further maximize the utilization of our label? Cool, so let's start with the first one, the synthetic data generation. So here we use a model, we call it a parameterized human 3D model. So we use GAMPs in this talk, but we can use any model such as simple or anything. So as I mentioned, the major challenges we are facing here is that there are actually very diverse pedestrian poses with a lot of few long tail cases. So there are really a lot of different type of pedestrians in the street. Most of them will be standing, most of them will be walking. But in many of the critical situations, we will have to deal with pedestrians with different poses. For example, they can be standing on top of maybe a luggage in on the road. They can be just sitting down there. Maybe some people may falling down due to some accident. People are fixing their cars. Lots of different situations. They are really critical for a really successful self-driving car product. But at the same time, they're really rare. And if you train a model, what you really want to improve is to improve those long tail cases. So what we do here is that let's say starting from some of the inputs. Usually you will have two inputs you can get. Firstly, you probably see some examples that your method doesn't really perform very well. You can get a point cloud of those examples. That's usually the first type of inputs. You can manually define some of the poses you are really interested. You know that your algorithm doesn't do very well. So these are two type of inputs. What we do here is that we can feed those inputs into a parameterized human models. For example, if your input is the point cloud, you can fit it into a particular parameterized model. Here we use GAMPs, we can use anything. They will give you the pose and shape of the pedestrians. This is for the first type of the input. And for the second type, you can also use fit GAMPs to generate some random poses or shapes on top of these skeletons. The next step we can do is that we can try to disturb a bit about the generated pose and shape parameters and generate a large amount of the meshes we can get. So for example, you can change the shape of the pedestrians a little bit. They can be more skinny, they can be more fit. You can change the pose a bit so that they are not just strictly sitting down. They can change a bit of their actions. And then we can go through something we call it realism enhancement. We make sure that these meshes looks very realistic when we generate the final point clouds. So this is just an overview of one of the potential systems we can do. So the field is actually proceed very fast. So basically you can do more end-to-end in this way. For example, you can just get input, feed your input, the two type of input. Maybe you can train a diffusion model and then they will give you the final synthesized pedestrians with special poses better. But in general, this is one of the workflows we could do here. And we actually try to evaluate it on top of some of the pedestrian classification tasks. So this is a very, very easy setting. You can just train a binary. Imagine you're training a binary classifier pedestrians versus background object. And here is some of the comparisons we have. The takeaway message is that the more diversified you can generate those poses, the better performance you could get. So in this table, the best performance we actually get is a combination of GANs and a lot of variant like perturbants of both shape and also pose of the pedestrians. That's actually conclude the first part of the talk. We can go to the second one. So suppose we get some of those data. I have to say those renderings, those perturbants, and also those generations are still expensive. So the questions we have next is that how do we generate, how do we utilize this label better, especially for some of the tasks that really need a very expensive labeling. Here we take an example of a 3D key points prediction. A very brief introduction about this problem is that it's really important for us to understand human pose in many of the vulnerable role user related tasks. For example, we want to really understand human activities, what they're doing, is it loading object, are they actually riding a scooter? And we need to have a corresponding different reactions to it. And especially if you want to drive in some dense urban area such as San Francisco, you will have a very close interactions with pedestrians. Understanding their behaviors is really important. And we argue that the 3D locations of key points is actually one of the really important representations you can leverage to understand those activities. However, it's really, really expensive to label those 3D key points. You can imagine that your labelers need to see the 3D space and try to label all the say multiple points in this space. That's just for one frames of the image. Usually you need a multiple frame. So it's quite an expensive task to label. So what we do here is that we want to try to leverage a less expensive labeling, such as, for example, instead of labeling the 3D key points, we can actually label the 2D key points instead. So basically, you are just seeing the image, you click a few points on the image. How can we do that? So the simple way we can do, before we introduce how we train the model, we can say how the model doing inference. That's more straightforward. Suppose your input is a multimodal inputs. You have the point clouds, you have the camera image. This input can go through some of the models. For the point clouds, you can go through a traditional point nets or something similar to that. For the image, you can go through the 2D camera network to generate 2D heat map of the potential key points. You're doing the modality fusion together to get the multimodal feature map. And then you go into some of the 3D point network. So you get the feature encoder, you regress the 3D key points, and then you can generate the final 3D key points predictions. That's a very simple plan to generate the prediction. The key here of this talk is how do we do the training. One thing we can do is that suppose we have the 2D key points, and then we can actually map it to the 3D key points locations. That's actually generate, we call it the pseudo 3D key points labels. You can do some Huber loss between your predictions and 3D key points. And in addition to that, you can also have some of the segmentation loss on this 2D key points locations. And with both the regression branch and segmentation branch, you can actually get a better key points. The next step we want to introduce is that how do we map from the 2D key points to the 3D key points? We're actually doing a very simple way, and it's actually worked pretty well. So the way we get is very simple. So we just try to find the closest point in the 3D space, and then utilizing that to train the 3D models. We also try to map the 3D predictions back to the 2D space and come up with the supervision on top of the 2D space. It performs much, much worse compared to leveraging it directly in the 3D space. this is just some of the examples we can see in some of the data we have. So you can see this is a really 3D space predictions from the key points. And they are all supervised directly by the 2D key points, 2D labels we got. There is a blog post for more details for how we utilize this in Waymo. And in this year's CVPR, we also further developed the model. We try to think about whether 2D key points is even needed. So this is just a teaser for the poster. Feel free to join the poster sessions later. The idea is that we can utilize some of the unsupervised losses to predict key points. Cool. Let's go to the third part of the talk. We talk about how do we do self-supervision. This is another way for us to leverage the power of the labels that we can get. So we'll take the pedestrian crossing action recognition as an example for these discussions, but it actually can apply to any of the high level reasoning tasks. The task here is that we try to understand whether the pedestrian really want to cross the street or not. For example, if people are crossing the crosswalk, that's a really positive examples of crossing actions. And in this particular examples, I'm not sure whether that's very clear on the screen. You can see somebody who is trying to picking up something on the street. They are very close to SDC, and in a certain positions, their face is actually face us as well. From a human perspective, we understand it very well because they are actually picking something. From the key point space, you can also say they are actually picking. So this is also a way for us to say that this maybe there is a better way for us to predict this task. The challenge of this task is that it's very ambiguous sometimes, needs some of the high level understanding. And the really important thing is that very critical crossing cases like jaywalking are very sparse in our data set. Usually people will apply for the traffic rules. And there are also many of the hard negative examples as what we see here. So they can be very close to SDC. Sometimes they also have a speed towards SDC. Towards self-driving car. But if you really understand their behaviors, their poses as a human, you understand they don't really want to cross. So the solution we want to propose here is that we can actually join predict multiple tasks together to leveraging to make sure that even if we have a very few data for the positive crossing actions, we can leverage a more large amount of key points to help us understanding it better. And we also find that it's because the data sparsity issues is really, really critical here. We find that we really need to some of the self-supervised learning tasks there. You can see that if we really directly feed the key points into the model, this is a very high dimensional input features if you also consider multiple frames. So we have to rely on some of self-supervised learning to make sure the net can actually learn. This is the general architecture, very, very simplified version of it. We have the rule graph, we have agent, we feed it into a context encoder to generate the context embeddings. These are all vectorized space. We also have a key points, we encode them. This is a sequence of key points. And then we convert it into the embeddings of the key points. In this way, we can actually generate the crossing actions, generate the trajectory predictions. And we also have a many of the auxiliary laws to make sure that the net can actually learn in this case. I will talk about this later in the following slides. The first supervision we do is that we call it a jigsaw puzzle. Suppose we have a sequence of key points, like what we're showing here. We can actually split it into multiple segments, and then we can try to change or switch, like shuffle the orders of the segment, and then we need the network to predict what's the right order of these pedestrians before the shuffling. So this is very important for the net to learn the temporal relationship among key point segments so that we can actually understand the crossing actions of the pedestrians better. The next one we are actually utilizing, we call it future key points prediction. So this is also very straightforward. We have a history of the key points. We try to help the network to predict the future key points predictions for the next time frames. And we need to use some of the smaller weight in the combined loss because this is actually a very hard task to predict. But it's very useful for the net to really learn what does it really mean in a sequence of key points. And the last auxiliary loss we use is the contractive learning. So suppose we can actually mask out some of the sequence and then try to net learn whether this is a positive pairs between the original sequence and the new sequence. This is also a way for us to enforce the high level temporal consistency among key point sequence. Some of the quantitative result here, not surprisingly, if we just directly train a model on a very sparse prediction task such as crossing intent is very hard, but with the key points and with all the auxiliary loss, we are actually getting better and better when we are actually having all these supervisions added. Some of the quantitative examples, the first one is the example we see in the beginning of the talk. It's a pedestrian who is trying to picking up something. And then from the key point space is much more clearer. And we find that without the key points, there's still the net can be confused with what the pedestrian want to do. With key points, the crossing likelihood is much more lower. Similarly, for a pedestrian who is actually stops waving and then start to turning the crossing directions. We didn't actually show the sequence prediction here, but with the key points, you will find that after the pedestrian stop waving with another pedestrian and start to cross, the crossing likelihood becomes significantly higher after we actually training the models together with both key points and actions. Cool. That's basically conclude the talk today. So as a summary, the goal for one of the challenges we are facing here is the data sparsity issues. But they are actually one of the really key problems we have to solve for self-driving car. There are multiple ways. From the data side, I think data synthesis and augmentation is one of the key tools we can leverage. On top of them, we can utilize weekly supervised and self-supervised learning to make sure that we can leverage those labels in a better way. Some of the future directions we have in our mind is that firstly, we probably need to have more end-to-end multimodal generations. So diffusion models is one of the very hot topic these days. And some of the vision language-based generated models, I think this is a really promising direction to go. Auto labels with foundational models, that's also one way we can leverage, and definitely more efficient self-supervised and semi-supervised learning. Cool. I think that's conclude my talk.